session of the bariatric program, and this is the most awaited one, the debate. So for this, I have immense pleasure in inviting the moderators, Dr. Lillian Kaur. She is the IFSO president. She's the leading bariatric surgeon in Australia, Asia Pacific region. She's a clinical associate professor at the Flinders University of South Australia in Adelaide, Dr. Lillian Kaur, and also Dr. David Lomanto, who's associate professor and director of
Dr. Lillian Kaur,
Singapore. She's the IFSO president. She's a clinical associate professor at the.
Hello, Randeep. Hi.
Hi. Welcome,
Thank
sir.
Thank you very much, Randeep.
Thank you. Welcome.
Thank you for the invitation. We are very glad to be here. Hey, Lillian, how are you? Great.
Yes, so, good. Thank you, David. And thank you for being my co-chairman today.
Great. I think you can go and start to introduce the session of the speaker. I will do the second
okay.
one.
Okay. All right. It is my pleasure to be sharing this session with David. It is a debate. And the debate is what is ideal for a Roux-en-Y gastric bypass? Is it a long biliopancreatic limb or a short biliopancreatic limb? So we have two very good speakers today. We got Dr. Manish Kaiten, who's going to talk about the long BPD limb. And we've got Raman Goel, who talked about the short BPD limb. So Manish, I think you're going to start and tell us why you believe that the long BP limb is better in a Roux-en-Y gastric bypass. So let's get going.
Good evening, friends. Thank you, Lillian, for the invite. Raman and Randeep, all our close friends and seniors. So can I have my slides now, Randeep? Or I have to share the slides. Hello.
Manish, have you
seen? Manish, share your screen down there when you.
Hi, Dr. Raman. My slides, I think I have sent my slides.
Sushil or somebody. Rajiv, will you locate his slides and put them
Avdesh, on? Avdesh, please look. Start the slide for Dr. Manish, please. Thank you.
Or Manish, if you have them, maybe you can share them from your end.
I don't know.
Okay.
Because it's not coming on my screen. Share कैसे करेंगे मतलब
जो डाउनलोड किए हैं
हाँ ये
उसको बोलेंगे हाँ शेयर
स्टार्ट करना पड़ेगा 1, 2, 3
No, you are sharing the sound, not the slides.
Yeah, so the central office does not have the slides, so you will need to do it from your own laptop, Manish.
Can you see it now?
We have a white screen.
No, sir. Please first of all stop your sharing, sir.
On BP limb. Is it there or not?
It's a white screen.
Again, share. Select your presentation and then share.
I have selected my presentation. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for the invite. I'll move fast. So you can see the whole role about BP limb we are talking about a limb which is purely malabsorptive let it be any surgery. And once we are doing a bypass surgery, the BP limb is going to be a pure malabsorptive limb. And there has been long debate now going on, and we know the surgery which is picking up nowadays is OAGV, which is purely based on malabsorption for the BP limb length. So it is not yet fully clear how the enhanced weight loss effect of a longer BP limb is explained. So BP limb is pure malabsorptive because there is no food, and elementary limb absorbs sugar and protein in future. That is after 8 months to 1 year. So from a theoretical point of view, a longer BP limb has a more pronounced hindgut effect. When the longer BP limb is measured and divided at the level of the enterostomy, so you pull the distal part to the enterostomy, and hence the food reaches to the ileum very fast. This theory describes the mechanism that the rapid delivery of undigested food to a more distal part of the bowel induces the upregulation of number of L cells in the intestinal wall, and L cell produces GLP-1. That in turn slows, shown to induce anorexia, the incretin effect, and the ileal brake, eventually leading to weight loss. RYGB was reported to increase circulating GLP-1 level early since after surgery. While GLP-1 is well known for its weight loss and hypoglycemic effects, therefore elongating the BP limb to 200 cm may favor early stimulation of GLP-1, producing cells by nutrients and consequently potentiate the weight loss and the anti-diabetic effect of the surgery. So short versus long BP limb, there is no cutoff point between long and short BP limb length. So there is currently no consensus on the total bowel length that should be bypassed during performance of the Roux and Y gastric bypass, and on the relative proportion of the BP limb in that. Reported lengths of BP limb can be from 10 centimeters to 2.5 meters. Long BP limb play an important role in percentage of excess weight loss, long-term weight maintenance, resolution of comorbidities, and in long-term less weight gain. So long-term gastric bypass is in the super obese. There is a trial, 75 versus 150 centimeters of BP limb, and the follow-up was for 48 months. 50% excess weight loss in group 1 patients and 64% excess weight loss in group 2 patients. The weight loss was reported superior in group who has longer BP limbs. Then again, there was a study by Nanes, McLean et al. Published a case series of 242 patients with either 10 centimeter or 100 centimeter BP limb. Weight loss reported in the change of BMI after a follow-up of 75 months, which is a quite long follow-up, was superior in super obese patients, with concluding that only this group would benefit from a longer BP limb, not less obese patients. And there was no macronutrition side effects unique to the long limb bypass were encountered in this super obese patients. Then again, there was a study with a 200 centimeter fixed elementary limb, and they used to perform a long BP limb. The follow-up was there for 7 years. Weight loss was superior in the long limb patients in all groups, with more than 90% of excess weight loss. So weight loss, again, as I have told you, was superior in 90% of the patients. Gastric bypass with long elementary limb or long BP limb, long-term results on weight loss. Then again, there is a paper which was observed that long BP limb of 200 centimeters gives a more, so lengthening of the BP limb gives significantly higher weight loss, lower rate of excess weight loss failure, and lesser weight regain along the better resolution of obesity associated comorbidities. And lengthening of the BP limb gives significantly higher weight loss, and there was no difference in hypoalbumin levels, which was noted there. A longer BP limb in Roux and Y gastric bypass improves weight loss in first year after surgery. Again, it was an RCT was done. So, achieved a significant increase in percent of excess weight loss, a long BP limb in a gastric bypass, where the BP limb was 150 cm and elementary limb was 75 versus BP limb 75 and elementary limb 150. So, they just reversed the ratio and followed it up. Then, again, there was a study which included super obese patients of BMI more than 50 and the BP 50, an elementary limb from 100 to 250 centimeters. Weight loss was superior within the long limb groups in all studies, and it doesn't actually depend if both BP limb was also long and elementary was also long, because this RCT was not very well defined. I have gone through the paper. So weight loss was superior within the long limb groups in all the studies. So now we do a surgery, then we are talking about not about weight loss, but we are also talking about metabolic control. So mechanism underlying the glycemic control of metabolic surgery is intriguing and has been heavily investigated, but still not well defined. I was listening eager today, and I totally agree with him. We try to find more, we know less. The more knowledgeable we think we are far away from the knowledge. We are just getting an idea about the gut and brain relations. So it is feasible that same beneficial effect on weight loss can be found in other procedures such as one anastomosis, gastric bypass, SADS, that on average is higher when compared to a standard gastric bypass in many reports now. Both procedures share the longer BP limb construction with longer BP limb as in gastric bypass. Although hard evidence is lacking, from a theoretical point of view, a longer BP limb has a more pronounced hindgut effect. And that is the reason we can say OHGP is also picking up. The rapid delivery of nutrients to the distal bowel will stimulate the secretion of GLP-1 and PYY. GLP-1 is an incretin hormone promoting postprandial insulin release and improving pancreatic beta cell function. GLP-1 is suppressed in type 2 diabetes, and GLP-1 agonist is now widely used in the treatment of type 2 diabetes that we all know very nicely. So gut hormone release after gastric bypass depends upon the long BP limb. The long BP limb RYGP group displays significantly higher fasting and postprandial GLP-1 insulin and C-peptide levels and were lower as compared to classical RYGP. So again, there was a gut hormone release after gastric bypass depends upon the length of BP limb. There is a paper by Patricia. The conclusion is that RYGP with a longer BP limb results in a distinctive postprandial hormone profile, which augmented GLP-1 and neurotensin responses that could be beneficial for the metabolic outcome of the surgery. The should RU and Y gastric bypass below pancreatic limb length be tailored to achieve improved diabetes outcome? Bad the diabetes, you make a bit longer BP limb. So RYGP with a long BP limb improves percentage excess body weight loss, type 2 diabetes remission, and glycemic control in those with persistent disease, while it decreases diabetic relapse rate also over the time. The anti-diabetic effects of long BP limb RYGP also are less influenced by the preoperative disease duration. The patient is having diabetes since how long, it is not that much related to that. This data suggests the RYGP procedure could be tailored to improve type 2 diabetes outcome in those patients, especially who have got diabetes since long and are more insulin dependent. A prospective single-arm trial of modified long BP and short elementary limb RU and Y gastric bypass in type 2 diabetes with mild obesity, and these are not severe obese patients. So the conclusion was that RYGP with long BP limb and short elementary limb is safe and seems effective in achieving complete control of type 2 diabetes patients. I may not agree with this paper completely because the patients are not obese, but now it is well established that the metabolic effect of a weight loss surgery is more because of BP limb, less because of a pouch or a small pouch or the stoma. So outcome of one anastomosis gastric bypass in 472 patients, there are hundreds of papers now which have been released. There is a better remission of diabetes mellitus, there is a good weight loss, and there is a good maintenance of excess weight loss after 5 years. And that is all because they lack a RU limb. And in fact, there is a long BP limb and there's no rule in there. An 8-year experience with 189 type 2 diabetes patient after OAGP. So 180 patients achieve HbA1c level between 5 to 6.2 without any medicines. Out of 50 who were on insulin, 9 achieved HbA1c level of 8 and had to take additional anti-diabetic medicines to achieve HbA1c levels less than 6.5. So our results showed that there is a marked reduction in blood glucose levels and HbA1c after MGB. Biochemical and clinical analysis showed a diabetic remission rate of 95%. So again, there are multiple studies which has been published with weight loss, short versus long, diabetes, short versus long, and a follow-up. The follow-up can be as low as 6 months to as long as 7 years, and we can see in long limb that there is not a much difference in diabetes between a short limb and long limb, but there was marked difference in weight loss. That is a 7-year follow-up. The number of patients involved were not too much in any of these groups. So very concrete evidence is not there still with us. So there are additional comments from these many authors. So gastric restriction combined with a modest degree of BP divergence results in a significantly greater post-operative weight loss in super obese patients. Only one or two studies has been done with a long BP limb in less obese patients to see the resolution of diabetes mellitus. The number of the patients enrolled are short, but the results reported are good. A long-term follow-up is still to be seen how they are doing good. And the nutritional challenges which are faced, only one or two papers have said there has been no hypoalbuminemia, which were reported in OAGB. Is not reported in long Roux-en-Y gastric bypass, but the time will tell how these patients are doing. Thank you. Hello.
I can't hear you.
Hello.
Hello. I have completed my presentation. Have you heard it or not?
Yes, very well, Manish. Yes, very well. Fantastic. I think you give us a lot of a number and a lot of evidence on the benefit of the long limb. I believe that maybe later we can have a bit of discussion, but after we give the microphone to Ramen, Dr. Ramen Gohel, that is the president of IAGS, and I believe is the man behind this huge conference together with Pawanindra and Swamurti and some more of the IAGS committee. Ramen, you have, I think, 10 minutes, right?
Yep. Thank you. Thank you, David. And it's a pleasure to have the president of IFSO and president of Obesity Surgery Society of India on the same platform along with David in IAGS. So I welcome you all here. What happened? Again, try to do this. Let me share my presentation.
Sorry, sir. Please stop your sharing, sir.
Pardon?
Please stop your sharing.
Yes.
And then go to share screen, sir.
Yes.
Select your presentation.
My presentation is selected.
And then share. Sorry, this is a whiteboard screen, sir. Yeah.
Same problem that we had earlier. So stop share.
Select your presentation.
I mean, presentation is already open. Okay, on the screen I have to select it. This doesn't happen in Zoom. Okay, I got it. I shared it. Send it to you.
Yes, sir. Please let's go.
Yeah. Thank you. So, friends. An interesting topic for debate, and it's a pleasure to be here as a host and as a debater. And before I go ahead, let me tell you that now in 2019-20, I do almost 60% Roux-en-Y gastric bypasses, and sleep percentage has dropped down to 39%. And another thing is that in my bypasses, all of them, the alimentary limb is 75 centimeters and BP limb are universally 50 to 75 centimeters. I'm not showing my results because they are published. But the important thing to realize is that Manish is, I and Manish shared so much between us that it was very difficult to even visualize that he will think differently. I thought he will come and he will support the motion for me. But anyway,
he was too. But you gave me a very hard task.
We go ahead with the data. So, friends, before we move in, let us set the goalposts. And why this is important? Because there are so many publications with such variety of descriptions that unless we clarify we clear the myth around it, the mist around it. So first thing is, are we talking of primary Roux-en-Y gastric bypass or revisional cases? Are we talking of elementary limb, fixed elementary limb with BP limb variation, or studies where BP limb is also varying and elementary limb is also varying, then we don't know where what the results, correct results are. Are we talking of weight loss or metabolic improvement or also nutritional issues or quality of life? And then obviously, we are in India, most of us, so we are looking at Indian patients versus Western patients. So let's start outrightly with revisional surgeries. As our own study of about 12,000 patient data in India showed that only about 1.35% of revisional surgeries are being done in India. So there is a logic being spread that this is a surgery in revisional bariatric surgery, we should have a long BP limb. But if a long BP limb is not done in primary surgery for reasons of deficiencies and nutritional issues, I think the same logic still applies when patient comes to you for a revisional surgery. So I think what's good for goose has to be good for gander as well. We know that. Now, the second thing is about this variables, because this automatically disqualifies most of the studies that Manish used to support his version. Most of the studies that he has mentioned have two variables. So either a long BP limb and a short elementary limb, or a short BP limb and a long elementary limb. So when you have a short BP limb with long elementary limb, and we know the elementary limb increases absorption, then less weight loss that is touted in these studies. And I'm surprised most of these are RCTs. How these studies could come to a conclusion about the BP limb length when they have been changing elementary limb in every study. So these studies, some of which Manish mentioned about Panero studies, Brolin study, a lot of them all have changed both the parameters. And when you have changed both the parameters, you cannot conclude that this effect was because of change in BP limb. So I think this is very important that when we are studying one particular parameter, we should look for this. Then there are many studies which are again quoted, like a Brolin study. These are the studies where they are talking of proximal bypass and distal bypass. But in all these studies, the distal bypass is with the fixed BP limb when they have a cohorts, and they only increase the length of the elementary limb. So this doesn't apply for the debate purpose. You know, if we had a debate on proximal and distal bypass, we would have used these studies. And most of these studies that have been cited are here along with the references, which are again not valid because they are elementary limb discussion. They are not a BP limb discussion. So we are limited not from hundreds of studies. We are limited to less than half a dozen studies where they have kept constant elementary limb and they have changed the BP limb length. This is the probably the level one evidence by Tower, where they have done a RCT, where they had an elementary limb of 150 centimeter in both cohorts, and in one group they had 70 centimeter BP limb and another 120 centimeter BP limb. And they had an excellent follow-up, 100% at 1 year and 93% at 5 years. So the validity of this cannot be questioned. And this is what they found. This is the bypass with 70 centimeter BP limb. This is the bypass with 120 centimeter BP limb. And they found that at 1 year, there was not a significant difference between the two. And even at 5 years, excess BMI loss was almost similar and there was no significant difference. This is a study which was published in 2019. As far as comorbidity resolution is concerned, this is again, 70 versus 5 year at 120, at 1 year diabetes remission, at 5 year diabetes remission, non-significant p-values. Hypertension at 1 year change and 5 years, non-significant difference. Even dyslipidemia, which we expect to improve, is not changing. And this is a major study that I thought must be looked into. And then they went on to assess the micronutrient requirement. And they said that after 1 to 2 years, 1 and 2 years after surgery, statistically higher requirements of vitamin B12, folic acid, and vitamin A in the long BP limb group. Why so? Because jejunum is the site for their absorption and these patients. At 5 years, they still require higher vitamin B12 and vitamin A, but no significant difference for folic acid. So this is a study which the first study that I wanted to highlight. Then there is another study, short-term results of long BP limb ruined by gastric bypass. They had 89 patients, 43 with BP limb of 150 centimeters and 46 with BP limb of 60 centimeters. And they found even at 3 years, the weight loss was almost similar compared to these. There was no significant difference. Definitely there is a figurative difference between the two, but statistically there is no difference in these groups at 1 year and 5 years. And there is no significant difference in resolution of hypertension, type 2 diabetes and reflux symptoms in both groups. Then to be fair to my friend and my brother Manish, let me tell this study that he quoted, Patricio's study. These are two studies which support out of these half a dozen studies that I mentioned. So the Patricio study had only 9 patients with standard BP limb. That means a BP limb of about 87 centimeters. While a long BP limb, there were 11 patients with 200 centimeters. And all they did was this was a retrospective trial. They gave them a mixed meal tolerance test. And they said there were similar plasma glucose excursion curves, but definitely GLP-1 levels were higher and the lower GIP levels were seen. But there was no difference in other hormones. So obviously, if the food is delivered faster to distal ileum, that is what ileal transposition is all about, then obviously the GLP-1 will be higher. But then there is another study, the only study which we found, the NORAS study that Manish mentioned, which mentioned indeed that the longer BP limb had higher weight loss or BMI loss, higher diabetes remission, and higher type 2 diabetes relapse in those who are having a standard BP limb. So probably this is the only study which, and this is a 2017 study, but otherwise, as far as RCT is concerned, we it doesn't support. And why is it so? Because there has been multiple studies and which have shown that the weight loss that happens is from first 100 centimeters of jejunal bypass. This particular study which has measured has said that most of the weight loss of bypass happens in first 100 centimeters and jejunum is more important. And then Mahawar in a study which was published in 2016 or 17 said additional malabsorption does not make a huge contribution as most of the weight loss is achieved with bowel bypass of less than 200 centimeters. And this is for a ruined gastric bypass. I am not quoting his one anastomosis gastric bypass study which was separate. Then this issue about is Roux-en-Y gastric bypass a restrictive procedure? Why a malabsorptive procedure should not be added to it? There is a logic behind it. The logic is that in a standard gastric bypass, only 6 to 10% of reduction in energy absorption happens. Rest of it is restrictive. Why? Because of the small pouch of 15 ml, the energy intake is so restricted that everything gets absorbed. So their malabsorption is not required. And that is why if you create additional malabsorption, you are going to create more problems for patient. The more problems of vitamins and more problems of so other issues. And the another issue is that Roux-en-Y gastric bypass only promotes lipid malabsorption. So there are studies which I will probably quote later, which shows that the lipid malabsorption happens in a standard gastric bypass. Protein and carbohydrate malabsorption do not happen. But if you increase the length of the biliopancreatic limb, the protein malabsorption will kick in, and that will be detrimental to patient's health. Now, as far as malabsorptive procedures are concerned, this is Phil Schwartz. The better results are obviously seen with pure malabsorptive procedures, but with greater nutritional deficiencies. And these deficiencies could be iron, calcium, which are standard in all, but these are specific for longer bypasses. So there is another study which is quoted by him, but the study is about common limb length as determinant of weight loss. And what Navez did was that in standard bypasses, he measured the common channel of all in all the patients. And he found that there was no correlation. Even if the common channel was 200 centimeters or common channel was 6 meters, the weight loss was similar. So he came to this conclusion that remaining common channel doesn't determine the weight loss. It is what the standard bypass length, which is around 75 centimeter and 150 centimeter of elementary limb. While long limb, this was I was quoting, while long BP limb is not required because standard bypass, and I have studies to support this, only fat malabsorption happens, but with long BP limb, the additional micronutrient deficiencies and protein malabsorption, which is actually not desirable. We are looking at weight loss and not protein malabsorption. So friends, to conclude, if you are converting a standard BP limb into a long BP limb, we are converting a purely restrictive surgery into pure restrictive and malabsorptive surgery. This is changing the basic character of Roux and Y gastric bypass. It is, you know, for once, I agree with Dr. Rutledge that the pouch of OIGB should not be very tight. It should be liberal so that the patient can eat well, because he knew that this procedure will have significant malabsorption. Because a malabsorptive procedure should not have restriction. So if you are making a 15 ml pouch, you cannot add malabsorption to this. So if you want to do a long limb bypass, I suggest you start calling it something else, like a diverted small pouch MGB or something else. So that's what my contention is. I'd be very happy to have your opinion. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ramen. Lilian, I pass you the microphone.
Thank you, David. We've just had two very good presentations. My question to both of them is, how short is short and how long is long? Because the small bowel in humans vary from 4 meters to up to 16 meters. So in a 16 meter person with what is considered short or long? So let me ask Manish first the question.
I'll be glad to answer that, Lilian. See, it is very imperative to know what is the length of the bowel in a patient, as you have correctly said. And even in a standard RYGB, as Raman has mentioned, with a BP limb of less than 100 and a fixed elementary limb of 80, sometimes severe malabsorption occurs because we don't measure the common channel or the complete bowel in our patients. Because now it is well stated that if you measure the complete bowel, there may be chances of injury to the bowel, which is not mandated in a gastric bypass. So we go, he's correct, a small pouch, a restriction added with some malabsorption, patient loses weight. And remember, obesity is a chronic disease, it needs a chronic treatment, and the patient has a very definitive role to play. But what we are seeing that these patients are losing the follow-up, there is no change in the lifestyle, there is no change in behavior modifications, are not there, and these patients come back with their weight regain. That is a big question mark for all bariatric surgeons all over the world. We are trying to find the solution to it. And definitely, anything which we are differing, which we are making it more, we are diverting from standard, are actually adding to the nutritional deficiencies. That I totally agree. What is the solution? It doesn't look in the sight. Is this correct or is that correct? If this is correct, a normal BP limb, then weight regain is a problem. If a long BP limb is correct, then nutritional issues are a problem. So the problems are everywhere. The definite solution is not lying with us. And thus, different surgeries are now coming up, SARDES or OIGB. Why they are coming up? Are they coming up because they are easy to do? No. A bariatric surgeon is a complete surgeon who can perform any surgery as per requirement of the patient. But they are coming up that we need a good weight loss because these patients are going to put on weight in long term. But I agree, nutritional deficiencies are yet to be assessed, yet to be seen, Even OAGB, I would say, is not that much. Let a 50 see the nutritional deficiencies. Let us have a follow-up which is between 90 to 100% between 5 to 10 years. And then we'll be more definitely saying, yes, this procedure is optimum for a patient with a good maintenance of weight loss, regain, and a maintenance of diabetes resolution is there. Thank you.
Manish, I fully agree, but I want to really know, because when I'm in surgery and I want to follow Lilian, I want a number. So what is short and short and long and long for you? Because at the end of the day, we need to cut.
For me, anything below 100 is a standard BP limit. We can say it is a short. Anything above 100 centimeters is not a standard ROAGB. I agree to that because you are making a standard pouch. No study is being done on the pouch size. We increase the pouch size. So anything 100 or below is a standard ROAGB. Anything above 100, yes, we can't say it is an ROAGB. It can be anything but ROAGB.
Okay, great. Let's listen to Raman.
Yes, so you know, most of the studies show the standard BP limb could be between 50 to 75 centimeters, and the standard elementary limb between 75 to 150 centimeters. So primarily we are looking at an overall bypass of about 200 centimeters, because anything more than that does not give any additional benefits. And this has been done in multiple systematic analysis done by Kamal Mahawar for OAGB and also for Roux-en-Y gastric bypass. So I think as far as the question of Lilian was concerned about the length, I completely agree. About 3% of women and 2% of men will have a bowel length of about 400 centimeters, 4 meters. So even if we are doing, let's say, a 200 centimeter bypass, these patients might have severe nutritional issues. But that's why we are now come down to 50 to 75 centimeter, 50 BP limb and 75. So we end up getting about 125 centimeters and we have a good weight loss. So I think my contention is that the follow-up and compliance and support of the patient is more important. And then even a sleep patient can lose more weight than any other kind of bypass.
Okay.
So I'm not sure whether we meant to continue, because I'm very aware that it's a plenary session that's starting at 6 o'clock and we are already behind time. But we've had two very good debates.
Yeah, we got in a chat announcement that we need to close in 1 minute.
Okay, so let's conclude by thanking our two debaters, Dr. Raman Goel and Manish Kitan, for a very good discussion on the long and short of a BP limb.
Thank you, Lily. Thank you, Raman.
Thank
Wish
you.
Wish you to see you all in next episode as soon as we are over with the problem.
I hope so.
Yeah.
I look forward to seeing all of you again in person.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much to everybody. Thank you, Lilian. Thank you.
For the plenary that is starting now, there's 4 orations. Natan Zundel is also taking one of the orations.
Okay.
So thank you.
So as the coordinator, I can give the vote of thanks to first Lilian and David to have logged in from Australia and Singapore different times. Thank you very much for accepting the offer and moderating the session. So we had an excellent creative made where David was right there and then followed by the IFSO president, IGS president, and the Aussie president. And I said, this can't be better than this with 4 senior most faculties. So fantastic debate. We've completely enjoyed it and I'm sure the delegates would have enjoyed it. Thank you all. And thank you, President IGS, Dr. Raman Goel, and President Aussie, Dr. Manish Khetan.
Thank you, Rati. Thank you.
Take care. It's our pleasure.
Hands off to you. You did a great job.
Thank you very much. Bye.
Bye. Bye. Thank you.